Winston S. Churchill, The Second World War, Volume 6, Triumph and Tragedy. Triumph and Tragedy is indeed an apt epitaph for the Second World War. After 6 years of struggle, Britain and her chief allies, the United States of America and the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, emerged victorious, but with the seed of conflict already sown between them. On all fronts, the Allies triumphed, though on some more quickly and decisively than on others. The status of the campaign in Italy continued to be a source of disagreement between the British and the Americans, and my grandfather always regretted the fact that more advantage was not seized from the opportunities he saw for an advance through northern Italy and on through the Ljubljana Gap to Austria and Vienna. He believed that this would be the most effective way of drawing German troops away from the Eastern Front and Normandy, and would also help to limit the Western advance of Soviet forces into Eastern and Central Europe. The latter factor weighed heavily on his mind as Stalin became more difficult and political dangers associated with the advance of communism into Eastern Europe became more evident. Much of my grandfather's time was taken up with trying to deal with the Soviets and to get satisfactory arrangements for those areas that they liberated. Most notable of all were his efforts on behalf of Poland. In his attempts, he often found the Americans lacking in their support for his objectives, and it saddened him that his rapport with Roosevelt suffered as the president sought to deal with Stalin personally on a bilateral basis. The decline of the president's health was no doubt also a factor in this. Against the Nazis, the Allies were winning on all fronts. The Soviets continued their heroic onward march into Germany and onto Berlin. Meanwhile, on the Western Front, there was the last great German offensive of the war in the Ardennes in December of 1944, but it proved to be the beginning of the end of German resistance. In Italy, the Germans finally collapsed, and with them also went Mussolini, brutally executed by partisans. 2 days later, on the 30th of April, Hitler committed suicide in his bunker in Berlin. The 8th of May was proclaimed to be VE Day, Victory in Europe Day. In the Pacific, meanwhile, the Americans prosecuted a two-pronged advance towards Japan. Between October 22 and 27 in 1944, the Battle of Leyte Gulf raged between the United States and Japanese navies. It was a decisive victory for the Americans. They soon retook the Philippines and were poised for the final attack on mainland Japan when the atom bomb was successfully tested and later used on Hiroshima and Nagasaki to bring the war to a swift end with Japan's surrender on the 14th of August 1945. The end had been foreseen for some time, and the Allied leaders had sought at both Yalta and Potsdam conferences to make satisfactory arrangements for the peace. My grandfather had grave doubts and misgivings about the outcome. He felt that the Soviets needed to be handled more sternly, and that the United Nations organization would prove to be nothing more than a talking shop. But there was now little more that he could do. In the British general election, the Conservatives were defeated, and on the 27th of July 1945, Clement Attlee formed a Labour government. My grandfather's great wartime role had come to an end. Of the end of a different war, my grandfather wrote this: "Merciful oblivion draws its veils. The crippled limp away. The mourners fall back into the sad twilight of memory. New youth is here to claim its rights, and the perennial stream flows forward even in the battle zone, as if the tale were all a dream. Is this the end? Is it to be merely a chapter in a cruel and senseless story? Will a new generation, in their turn, be immolated? Will our children gasp again in devastated lands? Or will there spring from the very fires of conflict that reconciliation of the three giant combatants which would unite their genius and secure to each, in safety and freedom, a share in rebuilding the glory of Europe. That was written in response to the end of the First World War. My grandfather knew only too well how the hope for rebuilding the glory of Europe was defiled by Hitler and Mussolini in the 1930s and 40s. After the Second World War, hope for the future was again blighted by the curse of totalitarianism. But I sometimes wonder how my grandfather would now feel and what he would have said about the end of the Cold War and of the present prospects for Europe and the future of the world. Perhaps he would amend triumph and tragedy to triumph, tragedy, and new hope. At least I know that would be in character.
Liberating Normandy was a supreme event in the European campaign of 1944. But it was only one of several concentric strokes upon Nazi Germany. In the east, the Russians were flooding into Poland and the Balkans. And in the south, Alexander's armies in Italy were pressing towards the River Po. Decisions had now to be taken about our next move in the Mediterranean, and it must be recorded with regret that these occasioned the first important divergence on high strategy between ourselves and our American friends. The design for final victory in Europe had been outlined in prolonged discussion at the Tehran Conference in November 1943. Its decisions still governed our plans, and it would be well to recall them. First and foremost, we had promised to carry out Overlord. Here was the dominating task, and no one disputed that here lay our prime duty. But we still welded powerful forces in the Mediterranean, and the question had remained, what should they do? We had resolved that they should capture Rome, whose nearby airfields were needed for bombing southern Germany, advance up the peninsula as far as the Pisa-Rimini line, and there hold as many enemy divisions as possible. This, however, was not all. A third operation was also agreed upon, namely an amphibious landing in the south of France. And it was on this project that controversy was about to descend. It was originally conceived as a feint or threat to keep German troops on the Riviera and stop them joining the battles in Normandy. But the Americans had pressed for a real attack by 10 divisions, and Stalin had supported them. I accepted the change, largely to prevent undue diversions to Burma, although I contemplated other ways of exploiting success in Italy, and the plan had been given the codename Anvil. But there were several reservations. Many of the forces would have to come from Italy, and they had first to accomplish the arduous and important task of seizing Rome and the airfields. Until this was done, little could be spared or taken from Alexander. Rome must fall before Anvil could start, and it must also start about the same time as Overlord. The troops would have a long way to go before they could reach Eisenhower's armies in Normandy, and unless they landed in good time, they would be too late to help, and the Battle of the Beaches would be over. All turned on the capture of Rome. At Tehran, we had confidently expected to reach it early in the spring, but this had proved impossible. The descent at Anzio to accelerate its capture had drawn 8 or 10 German divisions away from the vital theater, or more than was expected to be attracted to the Riviera by Anvil. This, in effect, superseded it by achieving its object. Nevertheless, the Riviera project went forward as if nothing had happened. Apart from Anvil, hanging somewhat vaguely in the future, some of the finest divisions of the armies in Italy had rightly been assigned to the main operation of Overlord and had sailed for England before the end of 1943. Alexander had thus been weakened and Kesselring had been strengthened. The Germans had sent reinforcements to Italy, had parried the Anzio swoop, and had stopped us entering Rome until just before D-Day. The hard fighting had, of course, engulfed important enemy reserves, which might otherwise have gone to France, and it certainly helped Overlord in its critical early stages. But nonetheless, our advance in the Mediterranean had been gravely upset. Landing craft were another obstacle. Many of them had to be sent to Overlord. Anvil could not be mounted until they came back, and this in its turn depended on events in Normandy. These facts had been long foreseen. And as far back as March the 21st, General Maitland Wilson, the supreme commander in the Mediterranean, reported that Anvil could not be launched before the end of July. Later, he put it at mid-August and declared that the best way to help Overlord was to abandon any attack on the Riviera and concentrate on Italy. Both he and Alexander thought their best contribution to the common end would be to press forward with all their resources into the Po Valley. Thereafter, with the help of an amphibious operation against the Istrian Peninsula at the head of the Adriatic, which is dominated by and runs south from Trieste, there would be attractive prospects of advancing through the Ljubljana Gap into Austria and Hungary, and striking of the heart of Germany from another direction. When Rome fell on June the 4th, the problem had to be reviewed. Should we go on with Anvil, or should we make a new plan? The American chiefs of staff, Eisenhower and Roosevelt, were resolved to mount Anvil and thereby weaken our effort in Italy. General Alexander, the South African leader General Smuts, and myself wanted to abandon Anvil and push forward the Italian campaign, with the possibility of an amphibious landing at the head of the Adriatic and an advance into Germany's southern flank through the Ljubljana Gap. The matter was warmly and candidly argued, and on the 28th of June, I sent a telegram to Roosevelt to try to break the deadlock. Mr. Roosevelt's reply was prompt and adverse. Roosevelt argued that he wanted to carry out the grand strategy decided upon at Tehran, but it was Mr. Roosevelt's objections to a descent on the Istrian Peninsula and a thrust against Vienna through the Ljubljana Gap that revealed both the rigidity of the American military plans and his own suspicion of what he called a campaign in the Balkans. First, the operation infringed the grand strategy. Secondly, it would take too long, and we could probably not deploy more than 6 divisions. "I cannot agree," he wrote, "to the employment of United States troops against Istria and into the Balkans, nor can I see the French agreeing to such use of French troops. For purely political considerations over here, I should never survive even a slight setback in Overlord if it were known that fairly large forces had been diverted to the Balkans." No one involved in these discussions had ever thought of moving armies into the Balkans, but Istria and Trieste were strategic and political positions, which, as he saw very clearly, might exercise profound and widespread reaction, especially after the Russian advances. For the time being, however, I resigned myself, and on July the 2nd, General Wilson was ordered to attack the south of France on August the 15th. Preparations began at once, but it should be noted that Anvil was renamed Dragoon. This was done in case the enemy had learnt the meaning of the original code word. On the 7th of August, I made a last attempt to modify the assault on the south of France. I met with Eisenhower and urged that the landing should be at Bordeaux and not on the Riviera. I was, however, unable to convince Eisenhower, and the next day I received a message from Mr. Roosevelt, which also insisted that Dragoon should proceed as originally planned. There was no more to be done about it. It is worth noting that we had now passed the day in July when, for the first time in the war, the movement of the great American armies into Europe and their growth in the Far East made their numbers in action greater than our own. Influence on Allied operations is usually increased by large reinforcements. It must also be remembered that had the British views on this strategic issue been accepted, the tactical preparations might well have caused some delay, which again would have reacted on the general argument. I now decided to go myself to Italy, where many questions could be more easily settled on the spot than by correspondence. It would be a great advantage to see the commanders and the troops from whom so much was being demanded after so much had been taken. While in Italy, in addition to military matters, I also had to deal with 2 difficult political problems. The first concerned Yugoslavia. I arranged to meet with Tito and took the opportunity to explain to him our immediate strategy in the Mediterranean. We also arranged for a meeting between him and Mr. Subasic, the new Yugoslav Prime Minister of King Peter's government in London. The other matter was even more sensitive and concerned the situation in Greece. I met Mr. Papandreou, head of the Greek government in exile. The pending German withdrawal from Greece had aroused speculation about the future government of Greece, and Papandreou was much concerned that it should not fall to the communist guerrilla forces. I advised him to transfer his government at once from Cairo with its atmosphere of intrigue, to somewhere in Italy, near the headquarters of the Supreme Allied Commander. This he agreed to do. As for the future, I told him we had no intention of interfering with the solemn right of the Greek people to choose between monarchy and a republic. But it must be for the Greek people as a whole, and not a handful of doctrinaires, to decide so grave an issue. Although I personally gave my loyalty to the constitutional monarchy, which had taken shape in England, His Majesty's government were quite indifferent as to which way the matter was settled for Greece, provided there was a fair plebiscite. We shall in due course see what happened. On August the 14th, I flew out to get a view of the Allied descent upon southern France. The assault took place on the 15th. It was well supported by naval forces and consisted of 2 American and 7 French divisions and 1 mixed Anglo-American airborne division. They were met with only weak opposition and moved quickly northwards, carrying all before them and receiving much help from the French resistance fighters. On the 11th of September, forces from Overlord and Dragoon were able to change hands. But for this, a heavy price was paid. The Army of Italy was deprived of its opportunity to strike a most formidable blow at the Germans, and very possibly to reach Vienna before the Russians, with all that might have followed therefrom. But once the final decision was reached, I, of course, gave Anvil Dragoon my full support, though I had done my best to constrain or deflect it. With regard to the future of the campaign in Italy, General Alexander was resolute that his now weakened army would do its best. But there was no hiding the disappointment he and other commanders, including General Mark Clark, felt about the transfer of troops to Overlord. In order to tie down as many German divisions as possible, another offensive had to be mounted. It began on the 26th of August. I was able to observe it at first hand with Alexander. This was the nearest I got to the enemy, and the time I heard most bullets in the Second World War. The next morning, plenty of work arrived, both by telegram and pouch. It appeared that General Eisenhower was worried by the approach of some German divisions, which had been withdrawn from Italy. I was glad that our offensive, prepared under depressing conditions, had begun. I drafted a telegram to the President, explaining the position as I had learned it from the generals on the spot, and from my own knowledge. I wished to convey, in an uncontroversial form, our sense of frustration, and at the same time to indicate my hopes and ideas for the future. I wrote about Alexander's plans to defeat German forces in Italy, and ended by raising once again the possibility of an attack upon Istria and an advance on Vienna. In his reply, the President expressed his confidence in Alexander and his army, and said that we would soon discuss the exact deployment of our forces. He ended by expressing the hope that the chaos evident among the German forces in the south of France would enable the 2 Allied forces to link sooner than we had hoped. We shall see that both these hopes proved vain. The army which we had landed on the Riviera at such painful cost to our operations in Italy arrived too late to help Eisenhower's first main struggle in the north, while Alexander's offensive failed by the barest of margins to achieve the success it deserved and we so badly needed. Italy was not to be wholly freed for another 8 months. The right-handed drive to Vienna was denied to us, and, except in Greece, our military power to influence the liberation of southeastern Europe was gone. Meanwhile, in Italy, Kesselring received some timely reinforcements, which brought his forces up to a total of 28 divisions. Then, aided by appalling weather conditions in late October, he managed to hold the Allied advance. Not until the spring of 1945 were the armies of Alexander rewarded with the victory they had so well earned and so nearly won in the autumn. We must now hark back to the Russian struggle, which in scale far exceeded the operations with which my account has hitherto been concerned, and formed, of course, the foundation upon which the British and American armies had approached the climax of the war. The Russians had given their enemy little time to recover from their severe reverses of the early winter of 1943. In mid-January 1944, they attacked on a 120-mile front from Lake Ilmen to Leningrad and pierced the defenses before the city. From Gomel to the Black Sea, the invaders were in full retreat. which did not end until they had been thrust across the Dniester, back into Romania and Poland. Then the spring thaw brought them a short respite. In the Crimea, however, operations were still possible. And in April, the Russians set about destroying the 17th German Army and regaining Sebastopol. The magnitude of these victories raised issues of far-reaching importance. The Red Army now loomed over Central and Eastern Europe. What was to happen to Poland, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, and above all to Greece, for whom we had tried so hard and sacrificed so much? Would Turkey come in on our side? Would Yugoslavia be engulfed in the Russian flood? Post-war Europe seemed to be taking shape, and some political arrangement with the Soviets was becoming urgent. On May the 18th, the Soviet ambassador in London had called at the Foreign Office to discuss a general suggestion which Mr. Eden had made, that the USSR should temporarily regard Romanian affairs as mainly their concern under war conditions, while leaving Greece to us. The Russians were prepared to accept this, but wished to know if we had consulted the United States. If so, they would agree. This matter caused considerable difficulties with the Americans. It was not until I had explained the importance of being able to take these kinds of decisions to deal with important contingencies as they arose that Mr. Roosevelt finally agreed, though still with some obvious reluctance. But this was only the beginning of our problems. The Soviet advance into Finland, Romania, and Poland, and their contacts with the Greek communists, stirred up a hornet's nest of problems for us. Of all these, the Polish question was the most important and deserves more of our attention. By late July, the Russian armies stood before the River Vistula, and all reports indicated that in the very near future, Poland would be in Russian hands. The leaders of the Polish underground army, which owed allegiance to the London government, had now to decide when to raise a general insurrection against the Germans in order to speed the liberation of their country and prevent them fighting a series of bitter defensive actions on Polish territory, and particularly in Warsaw itself. The Polish commander, General Bo Komorowski, and his civilian advisor were authorized by the Polish government in London to proclaim a general insurrection whenever they deemed fit. The moment indeed seemed opportune. On July the 20th came the news of the plot against Hitler, followed swiftly by the Allied breakout from the Normandy beachhead. About July the 22nd, the Poles intercepted wireless messages from the German 4th Panzer Army, ordering a general withdrawal to the west of the Vistula. The Russians crossed the river on the same day, and their patrols pushed forward in the direction of Warsaw. There seemed little doubt that a general collapse was at hand. General Bohr, therefore, decided to stage a major rising and liberate the city. He had about 40,000 men, with reserves of food and ammunition for 7 to 10 days fighting. The sound of Russian guns across the Vistula could now be heard. The Soviet Air Force began bombing the Germans in Warsaw from recently captured airfields near the capital, of which the closest was only 20 minutes' flight away. At the same time, a Communist Committee of National Liberation had been formed in eastern Poland, and the Russians announced that liberated territory would be placed under their control. Soviet broadcasting stations had, for a considerable time, been urging the Polish population to drop all caution and start a general revolt against the Germans. On July the 29th, 3 days before the rising began, the Moscow radio station broadcast an appeal from the Polish communists to the people of Warsaw, saying that the guns of liberation were now within hearing, and calling upon them, as in 1939, to join battle with the Germans, this time for decisive action. The Warsaw uprising now began, but the Germans responded ferociously and brutally. The General Bohr needed help, but none was forthcoming from the Soviets. The Polish Prime Minister, Mikulajczyk, had been in Moscow since July the 30th, trying to establish some kind of terms with the Soviet government, which had recognized the Polish Communist Committee of National Liberation, the Lublin Committee, as we called it, as the future administrators of the country. These negotiations were carried on throughout the early days of the Warsaw Rising. Messages from General Bohr were reaching Mikulajczyk daily, begging for ammunition and anti-tank weapons, and for help from the Red Army. Meanwhile, the Russians pressed for agreement upon the post-war frontiers of Poland, and the setting up of a joint government. For our part, the War Cabinet, in its collective capacity, sent Stalin the following message. The War Cabinet wished the Soviet government to know that public opinion in this country is deeply moved by the events in Warsaw and by the terrible sufferings of the Poles there. Whatever the rights and wrongs about the beginnings of the Warsaw Rising, the people of Warsaw themselves cannot be held responsible for the decision taken. Our people cannot understand why no material help has been sent from outside to the Poles in Warsaw. The fact that such help could not be sent on account of your government's refusal to allow United States aircraft to land on aerodromes in Russian hands is now becoming publicly known. If on top of all this, the Poles in Warsaw should now be overwhelmed by the Germans, as we are told they must be within 2 or 3 days, the shock to public opinion here will be incalculable. Out of regard for Marshal Stalin and for the Soviet peoples, with whom it is our earnest desire to work in future years, the War Cabinet have asked me to make this further appeal to the Soviet government, to give whatever help may be in their power, and above all, to provide facilities for United States aircraft to land on your airfields for this purpose. On September the 10th, after 6 weeks of Polish torment, the Kremlin appeared to change their tactics. That afternoon, shells from the Soviet artillery began to fall upon the eastern outskirts of Warsaw, and Soviet planes appeared again over the city. Polish communist forces, under Soviet orders, fought their way into the fringe of the capital. From September the 14th onwards, the Soviet Air Force dropped supplies, but few of the parachutes opened, and many of the containers were smashed and useless. The following day, the Russians occupied the Praga suburb, but went no further. They wished to have the non-communist Poles destroyed to the full, but also to keep alive the idea that they were going to their rescue. Meanwhile, house by house, the Germans proceeded with their liquidation of Polish centers of resistance throughout the city. A fearful fate befell the population. Many were deported by the Germans. General Bohr's appeals to the Soviet commander, Marshal Rokossovsky, were unanswered. Famine reigned. My efforts to get American aid led to one isolated but large-scale operation. On September the 18th, 104 heavy bombers flew over the capital, dropping supplies. It was too late. On the evening of October the 2nd, Mikolajczyk came to tell me that the Polish forces in Warsaw were about to surrender to the Germans. One of the last broadcasts from the heroic city was picked up in London. This is the stark truth. We were treated worse than Hitler's satellites, worse than Italy, Romania, Finland. May God, who is just, pass judgment on the terrible injustice suffered by the Polish nation. And may he punish accordingly all those who are guilty. These words are indelible. The struggle in Warsaw had lasted more than 60 days. Of the 40,000 men and women of the Polish underground army, about 15,000 fell. Out of a population of 1 million, nearly 200,000 had been stricken. The suppression of the revolt cost the German army 10,000 killed, 7,000 missing, and 9,000 wounded. The proportions attest the hand-to-hand character of the fighting. When the Russians entered the city 3 months later, they found little but shattered streets and the unburied dead. And such was their liberation of Poland, where they now rule. But this cannot be the end of the story. The curtain must now rise on a widely different scene in Southeast Asia. For more than 18 months, the Japanese had been masters of a vast defensive arc covering their early conquests. This stretched from the jungle-covered mountains of northern and western Burma, where our British and Indian troops were at close grips with them, across the sea to the Andamans and the great Dutch dependencies of Sumatra and Java, and thence in an easterly bend along the string of lesser islands to New Guinea. The Americans had established a bomber force in China, which was doing good work against the enemy's sea communications between the mainland and the Philippines. They wanted to extend this effort by basing long-range aircraft in China to attack Japan itself. The Burma Road was cut, and they were carrying all supplies for them and the Chinese armies by air over the southern spurs of the Himalayas, which they called the Hump. This was a stupendous task. The American wish to succor China, not only by an ever-increasing airlift, but also by land, led to heavy demands upon Britain and the Indian Empire. They pressed, as a matter of the highest urgency and importance, the making of a motor road from the existing roadhead at Lado through 500 miles of jungles and mountains into Chinese territory. Only one meter-gauge single-line railway ran through Assam to Lado. It was already in constant use for many other needs, including the supply of the troops who held the frontier positions. But in order to build the road to China, the Americans wanted us to reconquer northern Burma first, and quickly. Certainly we favored keeping China in the war and operating air forces from her territory. But a sense of proportion and the study of alternatives were needed. I disliked the idea of a campaign in northern Burma and felt that the reasons the Americans put forward for it were not compelling. Getting more supplies to the Chinese would not greatly improve their fighting ability. And as the Americans advanced across the Pacific, there were opportunities for building air bases that were within range of Japan. I wished to contain the Japanese in Burma and to break into or through the great arc of islands forming the outer fringe of the Dutch East Indies. Our whole British Indian Imperial Front would thus advance across the Bay of Bengal into close contact with the enemy by using amphibious power at every stage. This divergence of opinion, albeit honestly held and frankly discussed, and with decisions loyally executed, continued. It is against this permanent background of geography, limited resources, and clash of policies that the story of the campaign should be read. It had opened in December 1943, when the American, General Stilwell, with two Chinese divisions, which he had organized and trained in India, crossed the watershed from Lado into the jungles below the main mountain ranges. He was opposed by the renowned Japanese 18th Division, but forged ahead steadily, and by early January had penetrated 40 miles, while the roadmakers toiled behind him. In the south, a British corps began to advance down the Arakan coast of the Bay of Bengal, and at the same time, with the aid of newly arrived Spitfires, we gained a degree of air superiority, which was shortly to prove invaluable. The Japanese, who had strengthened their forces unbeknown to us, now counterattacked in the Arakan. They drove towards Chittagong, holding our 5th Division frontally, but then slipped forces round their flank to engage the 7th Division that was further inland, while at the same time threatening the supply line to the 5th Division. They now expected the 5th and the 7th Divisions to withdraw, but they did not. Supplied from the air, they stood their ground and fought. The enemy had only taken with them 10 days' supply of food. Now, unable to overwhelm our forward troops, pressed from the north by a division we brought from reserve, they broke up into small parties to fight their way back through the jungle, leaving 5,000 dead behind. This terminated the legend of Japanese invincibility in the jungle. In this same February 1944, there were sure signs that our central front at Imphal would also be attacked. We had our own plans for an advance to the Chinwin River, and also General Wingate's long-range penetration force, or Chindits as they were called, mounted a successful operation to cut the railway line north of Indao, which was used for supplying the Japanese. Sadly, Wingate was killed in the air shortly afterwards. The crucial encounter was to be at Imphal, and there General Schoons took up position on ground of his own choosing on the Imphal Plateau. The climax came in May 1944. 60,000 British and Indian soldiers, with all their modern equipment, were confined in a circle on the Imphal Plain. I could feel the stress amid all other business. All depended on the transport planes. On the principle, nothing matters but the battle, I used my authority. On the 4th, I telegraphed to Admiral Mountbatten, "Let nothing go from the battle that you need for victory. I will not accept denial of this from any quarter, and will back you to the full." I telegraphed Mountbatten again on the 22nd of June, but the finale came while his message was on the way. I quote his report. "In the third week in June, the situation was critical, and it seemed possible, after all the efforts of the previous 2 months, that early in July, the 4th Corps would finally run out of reserves. But on June the 22nd, with a week and a half in hand, the 2nd British and 5th Indian Divisions met at a point 29 miles north of Imphal, and the road to the plain was open. On the same day, the convoys began to roll in. Thus ended Japan's invasion of India. Their losses had been ruinous. Over 13,000 dead were counted on the battlefields, and allowing for those who died of wounds, disease, or hunger, the total amounted, on a Japanese estimate, to 65,000 men. General Slim now gave the enemy no respite, even though it was the monsoon season. At the same time, the Chindits continued to create havoc with Japanese supply and communication routes, and General Stilwell continued his steady progress and captured Mechina on the 3rd of August, thus providing a staging post for the American airlift to China. At this juncture, I was in conference with the President at Quebec, and in spite of these successes, I continue to urge that it was most undesirable that the fighting in the jungles should go on indefinitely. I desired an amphibious stroke across the Bay of Bengal on Rangoon, at the base of the Burmese landmass. We carried the Americans with us on the Rangoon plan, but the sanguine hopes which I had not shared that Germany would collapse before the end of the year faded. It became obvious that German resistance would continue into and beyond the winter, and Mountbatten was accordingly instructed, not for the first time, that he must do what he could with what he had got. And so we forged slowly ahead in the largest land engagement with Japan which had so far been attained. The good hygiene discipline now practiced by all our units, the use of the new drug, Mepocrine, and constant spraying with DDT insecticide kept the sick rate admirably low. The Japanese were not versed in these precautions and died in hundreds. The 14th Army joined hands with the Chinese-American forces from the north, which now included a British division, and by early December, with two bridgeheads across the Chindwin, was poised for the main advance into the central plain of Burma. In defiance of chronology, we may here pursue the story to its victorious conclusion.